Thanks so much for joining us for CBN News Today. I'm Ephraim Graham. New England is bearing down today, facing yet another winter storm warning. The series of storms in the last month has dumped more than 60 inches of snow in Boston, leaving the city to try and figure out where to put it. Heather Sells has the latest.
Once again, a winter storm system is targeting Boston. Forecasters predict 12 to 16 inches by the end of today. The problem is not the storm itself, but that it's coming on the heels of two others. A record-breaking 5 feet has fallen in the last month.
This is pretty much unprecedented.
They're melting snow in Boston, trying to get rid of it all, and even considering dumping it in Boston Harbor.
Plows had moved enough snow to fill Gillette Stadium 90 times.
Boston expects to spend double the $18 million it had projected to remove snow this year. All rail service is suspended in Boston today. On Monday, 50 people were stranded on their morning commute after snow filled up the rails. And schools are closed, marking the eighth snow day this year. For many, just clearing the snow from homes and businesses has become a big concern. Some roofs have caved in.
It's like slow motion, watching the whole thing come down. It was really slow. Wow. It was scary. But we all made it out.
Others are simply struggling to find places to put it.
There's nowhere to go anymore.
Most people understand, what can you do? You really can't control the weather.
Forecasters say more snow is possible on Thursday, and the relentless snow is not just affecting Boston. It's causing ripple effects across the country. Airlines canceled 2,000 flights on Monday. After three storms in a little over 2 weeks, more than 20,000 flights have been canceled, leaving not just a region, but a country that's already weary of winter weather. Heather Sells, CBN News.
The president is poised to ask Congress to authorize the use of military force to fight the Islamic State group. That request may come today, and it would lead to debate on exactly how to attack the Sunni extremists who seized territory in Iraq and Syria. In the end, that would lead to the first war vote in Congress in 13 years. Congress passed a resolution authorizing President George W. Bush to use force against Iraq back in 2002. Jordan continues its air campaign against ISIS following the brutal murder of a pilot. As Chris Mitchell reports from Amman, the pilot has become a national hero and his death a rallying cry.
You don't have to go far in the capital of Jordan without seeing a poster of the man burned alive by ISIS. His horrific death changed the course of this nation.
Before the murder of Mawad al-Kasasba, many Jordanians were unsure if they should be involved in the U.S.-led coalition to defeat ISIS. But after the horrific killing, public opinion shifted dramatically.
In Jordan, everything has changed, and all people are unity, more unity, and more insist and to eliminate this kind of cancer.
All of us, we are feeling very sad and very bad. We are all one community, and Mawad was one of us.
Jordanian analyst Urab al-Rantawi calls the death a turning point.
Before that, the government used to have some problems to convince the Jordanian people that the war against ISIS is our war.
While the public rallies around King Abdullah, Rantawi says the country's involvement against ISIS will increase, but only to a point.
More airstrikes, yes. More intelligence and security operations, yes. Maybe special forces for some surgeries here and there, yes. But ground troops deployed in Syria or in Iraq in big numbers, I think it needs a different conditions.
Those conditions would include other Middle East nations like Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states joining Jordan in the fight.
By creating a serious military forces and deploy them in Iraq, Jordan will be part of this. Mm-hmm. But to go alone or with a few countries, I don't think Jordan will do it.
Until such a coalition comes about, Jordan's air campaign continues, and according to a Jordanian general, is making progress.
ISIS has lost 20% of its capabilities, and more than 7,000 of their criminal fighters have been killed.
Many here still look to the U.S. for leadership. But as this man told us, in the fight against ISIS, which he calls Daesh, the U.S. is in the wrong position.
Leading behind is not good. It's not, no more. It's not good to be leading from behind. You must be leading from front. To lead people, to kill, to finish Daesh. Leading from behind, I don't believe it's good.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Amman, Jordan.
President Obama says he and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, quote, have a real difference regarding nuclear negotiations with Iran. In a campaign speech, Netanyahu criticized international negotiations with Iran and said his trip to the U.S. next month is an attempt to describe Israel's objection to Congress. President Obama says he will not meet with Netanyahu when he is in Washington, D.C., under the invitation of Republican House Speaker John Boehner. The president says he will not meet with Netanyahu because of the precedence for U.S. presidents not meeting with foreign leaders who are facing an upcoming election. U.S. Supreme Court Justices Clarence Thomas and Antonin Scalia are criticizing their colleagues for refusing to delay same-sex marriage in Alabama. They say it gives the impression the justices already have decided they will declare gay marriage legal under the Constitution. Justices Elena Kagan and Ruth Bader Ginsburg even performed same-sex weddings last year. Gay marriage was set to become legal in Alabama this week, but Sunday night, Alabama Chief Justice Roy Moore told state probate judges not to perform same-sex weddings.
Well, I think a redefinition of the word marriage is not found within the powers designated to the federal government. Do they go to multiple marriages, or do they go to marriages between men and their daughters, or women and their sons?
The Supreme Court is expected to rule on same-sex marriage sometime in June. An Arkansas lawmaker wants to allow the celebration of Christmas in his state's public schools. Republican State Representative Justin Harris has filed a bill that would permit Christmas trees, menorahs, and other religious holiday displays. School districts could create religious holiday displays as long as they also include a secular symbol or an image from another religion. Students and teachers would also be free to say Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, and Happy Holidays. Media analysts are debating the future of NBC anchor Brian Williams following his decision to take a leave of absence from the nightly news program. Williams's move came after a firestorm following his admission. His story about being in a helicopter that came under fire in Iraq wasn't true. Many analysts think Williams can survive, but some caution many of Williams's other statements are being scrutinized by fact-checkers to see if he embellished any other stories. And Maureen Dowd of the New York Times writes, NBC executives were warned a year ago that Williams was constantly inflating his biography, sometime to the point where it was a joke in the news division. Tim Graham of the Media Research Center spoke with CBN News about Brian Williams' credibility. He says it's harder to believe Williams' apology because he repeatedly made up a story about a very dramatic event, and that's not the kind of things that's easy to misremember.
I think that we feel that that he's compromised the integrity and the credibility of the entire news division. This is a news division that claims to tell Americans, you know, we're the ones you can expect to cover the facts. Well, if you can't even cover your own personal history without, you know, transforming it into some sort of Walter Mitty picture of heroism, you know, I don't know where you go from there, where you start.
Graham says if Williams had any kind of decency, he would step down from his role as NBC News anchor. They offer spiritual freedom in the foxhole, but now their beliefs are being called hate speech. See how the radical gay agenda is muzzling military chaplains. The story's next. The Canadian Supreme Court has opened the door to doctor-assisted suicide. The court struck down prohibitions and ruled Parliament should create a limited system of exceptions. The Alliance Defending Freedom has been helping groups who were fighting to uphold the ban on euthanasia. ADF Senior Counsel Brett Harvey states, suffering patients need sound medical treatment and real compassion, not encouragement to take their own lives. But it's not all bad news for the pro-life movement. The court ruled doctors cannot be forced to participate in killing someone. That protects doctors' rights to conscious and religious freedom. Don't Ask, Don't Tell used to refer to gays in the military, but now it could apply to Christians in uniform. And military chaplains are also facing the fact that at times, biblical values are even called hate speech. Our Chuck Holton has that story.
Chaplains have been an integral part of the military throughout our nation's history, bringing hope to the living and comfort to the dying. Now some chaplains are coming under fire from official government policy and must choose between their conscience and their commander's orders. The repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell worries chaplains who follow the biblical view of same-sex relationships. Congress stepped in, passing a bill that guaranteed the rights of all military personnel to exercise their faith.
I put in an amendment to the 2014 National Defense Authorization Act that simply expands in law, in statute, to be in compliance with the Constitution itself.
They can, in fact, bring their faith to the table in their work.
Ron Cruz spent 21 years as an Army chaplain and now heads the Chaplain Alliance for Religious Liberty.
Chaplains, and not only chaplains, but all service members, cannot receive recrimination for living out their faith.
Despite the law, many Christians and especially chaplains often find themselves at odds with military leadership. Some of the more egregious examples? Two Baptist chaplains forced out of the VA chaplain program for quoting scripture and praying in Jesus' name. A chaplain candidate and former Green Beret was asked to represent a faith other than his own because, quote, there are too many Baptist chaplains, unquote. A soldier in Afghanistan accused of engaging in hate speech because he had a Bible in his desk at work.
I got an email from a chaplain in Afghanistan who preached a sermon for his unit talking about the last days and the fact that there would be a rise in homosexuality. He got called into his battalion commander's office and was told, you cannot preach from that text.
Another example of this tension happened here recently at Fort Benning, Georgia, home of the Airborne and Ranger Training Brigade. A chaplain was asked to give a suicide prevention class, but what happened next exploded in controversy.
Captain Joe Lawhorn serves as chaplain for the 5th Ranger Training Battalion based at Fort Benning.
He wears the credentials. He's a pathfinder. He's a master blaster parachutist. He is a chaplain who really knows what it means to be a soldier.
Chaplain Lawhorn was asked to lead a suicide prevention class at the Mountain Ranger Camp. In addition to covering the Army-wide curriculum, he cited his own experience and shared his personal struggle with depression.
Joe, as a good chaplain, identified with him and said, I want you to know I've been there where you are. So I want to tell you how I have dealt with some issues of depression. And so he gave his Rangers a handout.
One Ranger took a picture with his phone and sent it to the Military Association of Freethinkers and Atheists, who posted it on their website.
During the presentation, according to those who were witnesses who provided statements later, said at no time did Chaplain Lawhorn say, mine is the only way, mine is the best way.
Not long afterward, his brigade commander censured Chaplain Lawhorn for giving the handout. In our investigation, the military's been unable to cite any written rule or regulation the chaplain actually violated. Meanwhile, the Ranger who complained received no punishment, although he violated Army policy by going outside his chain of command. Those actions speak volumes about how toxic the climate has become for Christians in the military.
You're in a very pluralistic environment, so you get all faiths and all walks of life.
Former Army Ranger Jeff Struker became a chaplain halfway through his 24-year military career. He's been involved in every major American conflict since 1987.
George Washington, when he formed the Continental Army, formed two branches, infantry and chaplains, and basically said, I need warfighters, and then I need men who can minister to the soul of warfighters. Any chaplain who is doing their job well is a force multiplier for a unit. That force multiplier term means that the unit is more effective in combat. Doesn't matter if it's a transportation unit, a hospital unit, or if it's an infantry unit. They're more effective in combat with a chaplain than without a chaplain.
Strucker says the vital role of chaplains goes beyond leading church services for the troops.
You need somebody in the unit who can deal with the spiritual issues of a soldier. No one else in the unit can do what a chaplain could do. 99% of the counseling that I did was people who weren't Christian. They came to me because I was there while the bullets were flying, and they needed somebody to talk to.
And that's not all the chaplain does.
I would say that there are 10,000 cases in Iraq and Afghanistan, this is not an exaggeration, where atrocities could have happened, but they didn't, because the chaplain was there to be a moral influence on the men and women that were on those battlefields.
Strucker says the current climate would make it more difficult to do his job.
If the point comes where my career is asking me to do something that my denomination or my relationship to God prohibits, then I got to leave the military over that.
You serve everybody with grace and dignity. However, when someone comes to you for counsel, you've got to be absolutely clear up front. If you're coming to me, I counsel from a biblical perspective.
I don't want to see good chaplains leave the military. I hope that many more good men and women will become chaplains. But if you can't do it in good conscience, you owe it to God to leave the military.
From Fort Benning, Georgia, I'm Chuck Holton for CBN News.
Up next, sleep. It's one of the keys to a healthier life, but so many of us don't get enough of it. But new technology is working to change that. We're going to show you how.
Hey everybody, I'm Lori Johnson, health reporter for CBN News. This is coconut oil, and it is so good for you. It helps prevent against colds and flu because it's a natural antimicrobial. It's a great moisturizer because it absorbs rapidly. But the best thing about coconut oil is what it does for your brain. It provides energy to your brain cells in a way nothing else can. So it helps prevent against Alzheimer's and dementia, and even reverses those symptoms in people with Alzheimer's. You can read more about the benefits of coconut oil on my blog on CBNNews.com and my Facebook page, and chat with me on Twitter on Wednesday.
Well, it is a new year, and Caleb, we all know what that means. Lots of people working on making healthier decisions about life. You're talking about changing your habits, going to the gym, cutting your calories. But you say one of the best things you can do is actually get a good night's sleep.
That is right, Ephraim. And there is some new technology that can actually help you with that. Sleep Number was an honoree at this year's Consumer Electronics Show for its new Sleep IQ technology. Mm. Ephraim, I actually went to the store to check out one of the beds that they promise the best sleep of your life.
Caleb, hey. How are you doing? We've been expecting you. Welcome to your Sleep Number store.
When people are sleeping, people seem to think that you're just like a battery just recharging, but is there more to what's going on in the body?
Oh, absolutely. The first half of the night, our bodies are taking care of itself. 80% of our body's production of the human growth hormone happens during the first few hours of sleep. And that's responsible for all of our bodily repairs, tissue repair. Our skin is being rejuvenated. Our hair is growing. Our immune system is rechecked. With that all being done, we shift into REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep, sometimes called dream state sleep. Okay. And what's happening there is anything that has to do with the brain is being rejuvenated.
Let's talk about the Sleep IQ technology.
Oh, you're gonna love Sleep IQ technology. I don't wanna tell you about it here. Let me show you in one of our Sleep Number beds.
All right.
And here we are in the X12 bed, which is our flagship. It also has Sleep IQ technology. And because we use the air to adjust your Sleep Number setting, mm-hmm. we can integrate sensors within that dual air technology. After I'm in bed for a little bit, it starts to pick up my heart rate. I motion all throughout the night, knows if I get in and out of bed, when I get back into bed, my heart rate and respiration, all my motion is registered. Then in the morning, what it does, on the application or the remote of my choice, it gives me a Sleep IQ score. And then it also informs me what percentage of the night was restfully asleep, when was I a little bit more restless, and I can take all that information and it will give me that Sleep IQ score. When you're done with that, you very quickly can begin to connect the dots of, well, what did I do during the day that affected my Sleep IQ score or my quality of sleep so much that night? Mm. So you learn to know better sleep. It is truly an empowering technology.
Well, what's special about the Sleep IQ Kids Bed?
Well, let me show you. You know, the Sleep IQ Kids Bed has 8 very smart features that are designed to help both child and mom and dad figure out the best way to adopt healthy sleep routines so they can be their best during the day. First of all, you can see that the bed has the head tilt feature.
Okay.
So when you elevate the bed about 15 degrees, it makes it very comfortable for the children to read so that they'll tend to do it.
Is that through the remote that you
yes,
do that?
The whole bed is driven by an application, so it's all done through whatever you're using for the application. So it could be your smartphone, it could be your tablet. As a parent, you can decide when you give them control of that. But the head tilt feature is also nice for those days when they're congested. You know, they have a cold or they have asthma. But if they have to get up at night to go to the bathroom or do something like that, as soon as they pop out of bed, it lights up underneath the bed again, and there's a glow all the way around the bed so they safely can go to the bathroom. And then when they come back in, it turns back off.
Now for the parents, are they notified if the child leaves the bed in the middle of the night?
They are. What's really neat about this is you can get this remotely. So a lot of times children like to go to bed with the lights on because they get afraid a little bit. So you can let them do that. And then when you get ready to go to bed, you can go to check, yes, they're in bed, and yes, their light's on, so I can turn it off from here. A nice feature.
That is pretty impressive. So Caleb, what if I am not in the market for a new bed or can't afford it? Is there something out there, some new technology that will still help me rest easier?
Of course there is, Ephraim. And actually a new app comes to mind, and it's called Smart Alarm. Now, the company says that it basically will turn your phone or your tablet into a sleep command center.
All right. First, how much does it cost?
Okay, the app only costs $2.
$2. Yeah. And what are some of the features? What does it do?
Well, the app monitors your sleep cycle and helps you wake up perfectly so that you are refreshed and ready for the day.
Right.
But get this, the app even records the noise. So if you're like a crazy sleeper, it's going to record and monitor all of that.
So all my years of denying that I snore would probably be over with this app.
The app does not lie.
All right. Well, that is going to do it. I'm Ephraim Graham.
And I'm Caleb Kinslow, and this is your Digital Download.
And welcome back to CBN News Today. Finally this hour, all those cups of coffee may have an unexpected side benefit for women. New research indicates it could cut the risk of endometrial cancer. Women who drank about 4 cups a day had an 18% lower risk of getting that type of cancer than women who drank less than a cup a day. The study leader said the researchers were not surprised at all because the results were similar to what previous studies had found. Health Day reports the researchers still don't know exactly why coffee might lower the risk of that type of cancer, but one reason could be that it cuts down on the amount of estrogen in the body. So drink up. Have a good cup of coffee. That is going to do it now for CBN News Today. Remember, you can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. Take the time to tell us what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can do it on Facebook or at CBN News on Twitter. Hope you'll join us again right here next time. Make it a terrific Tuesday, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow.